without any express assertions of fact being made. And there's another warranty to cover that eventuality, and that's the theory of implied warranty. There are two implied warranties for us to be concerned with. The most important one is the implied warranty of merchantability. The implied warranty of merchantability is found at the Uniform Commercial Code, Section 2.314, and every state in the United States has adopted the Uniform Commercial Code, and every state that adopted the Uniform Commercial Code adopted Section 2.314. And Section 2.314 says, in every sale by a merchant, there is an implied warranty that the product sold is fit for ordinary use. A merchant is a person in the business of selling products of that kind. So, a grocer is a peanut butter merchant, and a manufacturer of peanut butter is a peanut butter merchant. So, under Section 2.314, when that peanut butter was sold, there was an implied warranty that the peanut butter was fit for whatever purpose peanut butter is ordinarily used. And that warranty flowed, according to the cases, from everyone in the chain of distribution. That means, actually, it was the grocer who made that warranty because it was the grocer who sold the product to the plaintiff. But the warranty was made by the manufacturer, by the grocer, by the wholesalers, by all the middle persons that were involved in moving that peanut butter in the stream of commerce. But the next question is, to whom does the warranty flow? And of course, ordinarily, an implied warranty of merchantability would only flow to the purchaser. But there are three points of view prevalent in the United States about the implied warranty of merchantability in a product's liability case. There are some states that say that the implied warranty of merchantability flows to the purchaser and all members of the purchaser's household. That's the purchaser's family and the purchaser's permanent house guests, maids and butlers, and so forth. There's a second group of jurisdictions that says the warranty flows to all human beings whose contact with the product is foreseeable and who sustain personal injury, physical injury to their bodies. And there's a third group of jurisdictions that say that the warranty flows to all persons, human or artificial. An artificial person is a corporation or a business entity. That the warranty flows to all persons, natural or artificial, whose contact with the product is foreseeable and who sustain either personal injury or property damage. Now, those three views, those three points of view, are found at Section 2318 of the Uniform Commercial Code. And when the Conference of Commissioners on Uniform Codes wrote the Uniform Commercial Code, they knew they were going to have trouble with that section. They knew that they would not be able to get all the states to agree. So they enacted, or they wrote that section in three different forms. Alternative A, Alternative B, Alternative C. And the states were then left to decide which of those alternatives they want. Some states chose Alternative A, which says the warranty flows only to members of the purchaser's household. Some states chose Alternative B. The warranty flows to human beings whose contact with the product is foreseeable and who sustain personal injury. Some states chose Alternative C. The warranty flows to human beings and artificial persons whose contact with the product is foreseeable and who sustain either personal injury or property damage. If you want to know what the law is in your own state, you have to turn to your state's Uniform Commercial Code. However, for the purpose of taking an exam in law school, I think you better talk about all three points of view and apply them to whatever situation the plaintiff was in this particular case. All right, now we know that the implied warranty of merchantability flowed from the manufacturer and from the grocer to the plaintiff, who happened to be the spouse of the purchaser. But was the warranty breached? What is this warranty? The warranty is that the peanut butter was fit for ordinary use. Is smooth peanut butter unfit for ordinary use just because it has a whole peanut in it? I don't know. If the plaintiff hired me, I would argue that it is unfit for ordinary use. I would say the ordinary use of smooth peanut butter is that it can be eaten with a spoon without any fear of choking on solids in it, that it can be eaten without chewing, that it can be spread smoothly or eaten without spreading at all. On the other hand, if I were speaking for the defendant, I would say the ordinary use of peanut butter is to spread it on something and eat it that way rather than to eat it with a spoon, because if you eat peanut butter with a spoon, there is a danger of choking on it, and so that's not part of the ordinary use. Remember, it's not the conclusion that counts, it's the argument you make that leads to the conclusion. I said there were two implied warranties that we need to be concerned about. The other one is found at Section 2315 of the Uniform Commercial Code. 2315 of the Uniform Commercial Code says that when the defendant is a professional seller and knows that the plaintiff is relying on the defendant's judgment in selecting a product to fit the plaintiff's particular purpose, and when the defendant knows what the plaintiff's particular purpose is, the defendant impliedly warrants that the product will be fit for the plaintiff's particular purpose. I don't think it applies very much in the peanut butter case, but suppose that I went into a shoe store and I said, I want to buy a pair of hiking boots, and they sold me a pair of hiking boots. Well, that would probably mean that they were warranting that the boots were fit for hiking in. But suppose I said, I'm going to go hiking on Mount Everest, where it's very, very cold, and I want a good pair of boots for that hike.
Yeah, I had to finish that.